हेलो डॉक्टर निखिल। आई
हेलो सर, हाउ आर यू।
एम फाइन, थैंक यू।
हेलो संतोष सर, हेलो उमेश सर, राजेश सर,
हेलो।
हाय रुचि मैम, गुड
हाय, गुड
इवनिंग।
इवनिंग।
आई कांट हियर एक्चुअली। शुड वी स्टार्ट एट 5:15 शार्प?
या स्पीकर्स रेडी? दे हैव नॉट जॉइंड एक्चुअली, वी आर ओनली 7 ऑफ अस।
या वी विल वेट। सर, आई विल इंट्रोड्यूस द चेयरपर्सन। हाँ, आएंगे। ओपीएल खत्म नहीं हुआ आई थिंक। सर, आई विल इंट्रोड्यूस द चेयरपर्सन एंड देन यू विल टेक ओवर फ्रॉम देयर, ठीक है? स्क्रीन। Good evening, ma'am.
Hi, Mita. How are you?
Good, good, good.
That was very, very nicely conducted in the afternoon.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am.
I'm
Finally, we are doing
you.
Some scientific.
No, the way you were nice. Everything was nice.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you.
My presentation is with you guys. Huh? You have to share the screen for me.
I don't have anything, huh?
Sumit has it. So, Sumit.
Okay.
I have sent it to Sumit.
Okay.
Because I'm not very sure I can share it from my end.
Okay. We'll begin as soon as we can.
Hi, Ruchi, ma'am. How are you?
I'm good, ma'am. How are you? It's nice seeing you after a long time.
I know. Lot of mucor work now for y'all over there now.
Yeah.
How do you all treat? What is the standard of care over there now if a patient walks in?
I think first one has to see what all comorbidity is there. That has to be targeted.
No, if there is an eye involvement, how do you all go about it?
Ma'am, depending on like if it is just the orbital apex, then usually we have been trying some retrobulbar amphotericin B also.
Is it working? Because even I have given 3-4 people. That's
ma'am, we are not sure because the IV ampho is also going on simultaneously.
Correct.
We did see some response in a couple of patients, but we are not sure whether it was due to the systemic treatment or whether you have to, you know, stop the systemic treatment, then only you can really know what's...
No, in Mumbai, no, we are running out of liposomal amphotericin B. So I have treated two patients of mine without systemic. And from -4, they have come to -2.
Ma'am, the thing is that it, you know, you cannot use it standalone. It has to be the debridement is the primary thing.
Yeah, so the ENT people then went ahead and debrided. I couldn't give him liposomal anything else IV because he had renal compromised factors.
Yeah.
And his potassium fell down to 2. So there was no way that I could go ahead and give
actually, you know, these patients cannot be treated by ophthalmologists alone. It's primarily a domain of ENT people and medicine.
Yeah.
So we have actually, you know, a big task force comprising of all specialties. We all look after the, you know, concerned part. And, you know, you really need to work together. You cannot treat it
alone. They have declared it as an epidemic. So it's a notifiable disease now. So everybody has to work in conjunction only.
Yeah.
Anyway, you're doing a great job, ma'am. Really
Thank
proud
you.
Of you. Hi, Ragini.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Mute. Round the clock, Nikhil. Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you so much. Hi, Rajesh bhai.
Hi, madam.
Umesh bhai, Santosh bhai. Hi, Pranav.
Hello. Good evening, ma'am.
Madam has to join, na?
Madam is there, and Nishanbagh madam is also there.
Yes.
Hi, Santosh.
Hello, madam.
Good evening, Ragini. How do you have so much of energy to go through all this? You tell me that first.
Your blessings.
Ma'am, she has a bed right across her. No, I think she sleeps in their the workplace only.
Whatever it is, ma'am, it is really commendable. It's really,
Thank
really
you.
Commendable.
This, somehow or the other, I changed my position today. I'm not careful and everybody can see the bed today. Normally, I hide it, you know. So this has been my home. This is my office. And this has been my home in the last 14 months. on and off when I don't go home. So this time it has been 21 days that I've been here.
We are really proud of you, the way you're going about it, and difficult to find somebody like you.
Nikhil Kashyap madam has joined.
Yes, so should we begin?
Yes.
Yes, so we can.
Welcome, Bharti. Welcome. Welcome, Pranav. Umesh has also joined. Welcome.
I take this opportunity to thank everybody for coming here today, and so the chairman will take over the session soon, but before she does, I need to introduce this dynamic lady, Dr. Bharti Kashyap, and not only her, but I think we have Nita, Ruchi, all the dynamic ladies and the boys, I must say, of BOA and Mumbai Ophthalmic Association. Dr. Bharti Kashyap, ma'am, runs a huge hospital and is a big advocate of SICS. Though she's a prolific surgeon in different types of surgery, including SICS and PECO emulsification, she has received the Nari Shakti Award by the hands of the Honorable President, and you can see her in the DP looking as lively, enthusiastic as ever.
Wow.
Today she was late. Today she said that, you know, she couldn't come, but I told her you have to come, because today being a Sunday, she's busy with the social activities of the IMA, whom she is an integral part of, and the president. She's the scientific committee chairperson of the Jharkhand Ophthalmic Society. And with Kashyap sir, Bibhuti, and everybody, she does a lot of good for the ophthalmology community and for the patients. I welcome you, ma'am, on behalf of Dr. Lahane sir, BOAMS, and everybody present here today. Ma'am, the session is all yours.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for such a nice introduction. So the SICS technique is very important, and this supervised responsible teaching of SICS technique is the need of hour, which is the primary responsibility of leaders of various ophthalmic societies. So till recently, SICS was considered as a low-tech, unproven, poor cousin to the gold standard PECO emulsification. Several recent articles have demonstrated almost equivalent outcomes of PECO and SICS. The proven advantage of PECO is a statistical significant benefit in induced astigmatism of 0.4 adapter, but the clinical significance of this statistical significant difference is debatable. On the other hand, hard nucleus drop with PECO has a higher relative risk compared with SICS. People argue SICS is worse for endothelium, but the proper studies have shown no difference in endothelial loss between SICS and PECO. And there are several types of SICS. Some are very elegant and sound in principle than others. So there is a reason for PECO surgeons to learn SICS, as 100% PECO is not possible. Even the most experienced surgeons have to need to bail out sometimes, even if it is due to the machine failure. So therefore, SICS is really not so much as an alternative, but can be an additional technique in our armamentarium. So there is a welcome trend in our country, both for MSICS, SICS, Smart SICS. We have a place in our armamentarium for all. So these techniques are complementary to each other and are here to stay. So with this, I'm going to invite the Dr. Ruchi Goyal, our first speaker. Is she here, Dr. Ruchi, madam?
Yes, she's here.
Okay, Dr. Ruchi is a director and professor, MAMC, GNEC, New Delhi. She is a very eminent oculoplasty and cataract surgeon. Her current assignment is Member Task Force Delhi for mucormycosis management. So today she is going to talk on premature entry in SICS. So welcome, Dr. Ruchi, and over to Dr. Ruchi.
Thanks, Dr. Bharti, and of course, always thanks to BOA for inviting me to this conference. And it's, you know, it's really wonderful to be a part of BOA, and we are missing out the beautiful that lakeside view and everything in Bombay, which we miss in Delhi. So
hopefully soon, Ruchi, and you are a wonderful
surgeon and a great human being. Thank you, Ruchi, for being here. Thank you, ma'am, for introducing.
Just a minute, I'll just share my screen. Yeah. Okay. So I have to speak on premature entry. You can see, view my slides now.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Clearly. Okay.
So though it's a very basic topic, but I think for any small incision cataract surgery, it is very important to construct the wound properly. And most of the talks there, they kind of move around the external incision, and the internal incision is kind of, you know, not discussed to that extent, although it is equally important. Now, when I talk of internal incision, I mean when you enter from the external wound, which is usually about 1.5 to 2 millimeter behind the limbus, and then you go in, dissect into the cornea, and then you enter into the chamber. Now, the importance is that just behind it is the root of the iris. So if this incision is not created properly, this valve will not form. And if this valve doesn't form, then this iris tends to come and plug the wound, and the nucleus tends to get blocked in its exit from the anterior chamber. Now, how does the, you know, the importance of this valve function when at the end of the surgery, we hydrate the ports, the IOP rises, and this particular iris, this is pushed back, and this wound goes and sits here. So this wound gets closed. Now let's see a small video, and I'll demonstrate the importance of identifying and dealing with it. So this is a usual small incision cataract surgery being done. And it is extremely important to dissect the conjunctiva and the tenons properly so that we have a good incision externally. This external incision has to be kept and placed. The size depends not only on the size of the nucleus, but also on the amount of pre-existing astigmatism, which will be discussed subsequently. My usual choice is a frown incision. And this frown is usually placed about 2 millimeter from the limbus here at the center. And as you go towards the periphery, the distance becomes about 4 millimeter. This is a crescent blade being used. And what is important is that when you're dissecting forwards, as soon as you reach the limbus, you have to tilt your blade so that it moves a little upwards. Because if you continue to dissect from in the same plane as you started, you tend to have a premature entry. So you have to dissect at least 1 to 2 millimeter within the cornea to create this internal valve. And it is very important that one should not use the blades that are not sharp and they're not of good quality. This is the keratome being used to enter the anterior chamber now. Now you can see there is a cut in the Desmitz that creates the internal valve. So this internal incision is nearly 8 millimeter to sometimes, depending on the size of the nucleus, even larger. And the nucleus comes out by the hydro pressure, which is being created by the anterior chamber maintainer, and the pressure which is being applied with the iris repositor. So the whole mechanism is basically functioning, because as soon as, you know, the nucleus comes out, this valve would close. You can see it goes and sits back. Now this whole mechanism would function if it is created at an appropriate place. Now just look at this video. The incision started off well, but once I entered over here, you can see there is a dimpling which is occurring. Can you see this dimple? So this dimple is an indication that there has been a premature entry. And as soon as you have a premature entry, you can see the globe has become hypotenuse, and the fluid starts leaking out. It becomes difficult to dissect the tunnel. So at this particular stage, if you identify that you have had a premature entry, it is better that you put in some viscoelastic, you create a side port, do the staining of the anterior capsule, wash the trypan blue dye. You can see these folds. And then after that, you put viscoelastic and then complete the tunnel. The other way, thing is that once you have done this, you have to change the plane. So this is the keratome knife being used to change the plane, because if you continue in that plane, you will end up having a even further, the entry would be near the root of the iris. Now, the problem that occurs in these patients is that there is not adequate buildup of hydropressure because the valve is not acting anymore. So the hydropressure created is insufficient, and at times it becomes difficult for the see. Now you can see this was the premature entry site, and see the fluid is coming out. Otherwise, in normal situation, this should have closed shut and there would be no fluid leak once the nucleus is out. So this is the IOL being put. Now in these patients, it is best to suture the wound. Otherwise, there will be a postoperative hypotony. Now this is another case where again a premature entry occurred. And you can see this was while the nucleus is being delivered, the nucleus is not popping out. That means the hydropressure is not being created. So once you have a situation like this, it should kind of alert that something like this has happened. Why is the pressure not building up? And you can see that instead of the nucleus, the iris is tending to plug the wound. So this is what happens when you make a entry close to the iris root. And you, the more you try to put it in, the more it's going to come out, and the more trauma is going to occur to the iris. And ultimately, you may end up with an iris chafing or sometimes even iridodialysis. If you try to pull out this nucleus with the iris plugged into the wound, you may end up with the iridodialysis. So it is best that you push it back, put in some viscoelastic, or maybe sometimes you can make use of a sheet's glide to protect the iris at the back. Otherwise, the iris tends to get injured. So it becomes a little cumbersome. You have to keep on injecting sometimes viscoelastic to the anterior chamber to build up the pressure. Now the hydro pressure may not be sufficient, and again, see, this is the iris which was plugging and it was not allowing the nucleus to come and also not allowing the pressure, hydro pressure, to be created. So you remove the anterior chamber, and either you can do the cortical wash before, or at times if it really becomes too much of a problem, then what you can do is you can just put one suture, do a cortical wash to the side port, put in, remove the sutures, put in your IOL, and then reassess, put a pilocarpine and reassess whether the iris is still coming, and if required, suture the wound. So this is the IOL. So here you may require a high molecular weight viscoelastic to push the iris back so the IOL can be put in. Otherwise, what happens is as soon as you open the wound to put in the IOL, again the iris would prolapse. So that is another important thing to be done. Use sodium hyaluronate at this stage. And at the end of the surgery, after hydrating the ports, see if you still feel it is best to put a cross-shaped suture to seal the wound. So whenever you have a premature entry, the important take-home messages is identify early. And you, if you have it at the initial stage, you can always change the plane. It is best managed at lat level and easiest. If you have already had a premature entry and you want to change the site, what you can do is you can use the keratome to complete the tunnel and create an opening anterior to what you have created. If you identify it at the time of nucleus delivery and you're using a anterior chamber maintainer, the hydropressure may not be sufficient. So you can use viscoelastic, that is 2% methyl cellulose, through the anterior chamber maintainer to push the nucleus out. And always, always, at the end of the surgery, if the wound leaks, you must put a suture. Thank you so much.
Excellent presentation, Ruchi madam. Are there any questions to Dr. Ruchi by anybody? Or should we take questions at the end of the session?
So you use regularly the ACM maintainer?
That is my favorite, but yes, I can do SICS with any kind of technique.
So do you regularly use Vectis or ACM?
As I said, I sometimes use Vectis. Whatever is given to me, I can use it now.
it's a very nice learning video, and we all the beginners should remember that whenever we make just to prevent premature entry, the dissection plane should not be very, very deep. And whenever we start dissecting, we should sweep the crescent knife from right to left or left to right, and we should try to find out a correct plane. And the rule is that when we are making a scleral tunnel, the heel should be up, and when we are making a corneal tunnel, the heel of the crescent should be down. So, and as the cornea is lamellar, first corneal dissection should be done, and when we are coming out, there should be a sclera should be cut. That way, proper plane is maintained. So now the over to the second speaker. And second speaker is myself. So my topic is SICS in black cataract with SFT for colobomatous pupil repair. So I'm starting my video. It has a voiceover, and it is 10 minutes because I was told to make a 10-minute video. So earlier it was 4 minutes. I made it 10 minutes.
Madam, chairman is allowed to take 10 minutes.
Okay, thank you so much. But it took a lot of time to make it the 4 minutes to enlarge to 10 minutes. Yes. So I'm starting it.
Yes, please. Please share your screen, madam.
Hitesh? I'm doing. Okay, Dr. Sumit Lahane. Okay, I'm taking him. Yes. So Dr. Sumit Lahane is Assistant Professor of Ophthalmology Department, Sir JJ Hospital. He has keen interest in ocular surface disease. He is doing so much of work with Dr. Ragini Madam and Lahane Sir. So welcome, Sumit. And topic is interesting cases in SICS. So over to Dr. Sumit Lahane.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much for kind introduction. And I'm honored to present in with all the seniors.
You're sharing Shanbhag Madam's. Sumit.
That will be next. Now I will change to mine. Is it visible, sir?
Yes, it is visible. Nice.
Sumit, could you hear me?
Yeah.
May I start?
Yes, please. Yes,
sir. So, good evening, everyone. And my presentation today is interesting cases in SICS. And when this presentation was given to me, I was thinking what cases to present basically. And then I found this very nice line written here that nothing can be interesting if you are not interested. So every case that we do as a surgeon, we are very much interested in it. And though complicated or simple, we do it as our first case. That's what makes a better surgeon every day. So I will not be going much into the theory. White cataract, as all of you know, it's a difficult surgery to do without a glow, dense nucleus, and difficult in the rexus with the poor visibility. There are various ways to manage it, including dye-assisted rexus, poor proper internal tunnel dissection, and the larger rexus. So I'll be showing one of the cases of hypermature cataract here. Okay. Making a conjunctival flap. And incision, what we do here is modified Blumenthal incision, 1.5 to 2 millimeter behind the surgical limbus, and a crescent blade to dissect sclerocorneal tunnel and the dissection of the sclerocorneal pockets, which is very important. Now, in this case, we very important when you go into the limbus, at least 1 to 2 millimeter, as Ruchi ma'am just showed, the dissection of the internal lip is very important. Now see, when you are entering, this has been taught to us that you need to see a dimple formation before the entry. Something like this, simulating what we see. And then you enter, so then you can make a three-planar incision, because SICS, the base, the pillar of the surgery is the self-sealing three-planar incision, which makes the surgery sutureless. Now again, creating a rexus in such case is difficult. So what we had tried here is doing a simple envelope technique. We just opened and the liquefied cortex leaks out, and then the hard nucleus without any cortex can be easily prolapsed into the anterior chamber. Here Blumenthal glide is used. Sheets glide is used Blumenthal technique to deliver the nucleus. The brown nucleus, hard but small, because most of the part is occupied by the liquefied cortex. I want to show this part, that this is how we done the envelope technique, and there is a triangular flap you can see. You put the IOL like always behind your flap. Make a cut with the vanas, and like you do an extension of the X-ray simply, you can pull out the remaining anterior capsule. So this is much easier than trying to do a surgical simple circular rexis in before removing the cataract. Another case, another hypermature cataract. I will skip few steps here. This is again repetition dissection of the sclerocorneal pocket. Here we tried attempting to rexis, but again capsule is very much calcified, adherent, but that does not change our technique. We follow the same technique, making a three-planar incision. Dissection of the inner lip is very important because it is much larger than your outer lip. Also, the technique that we use, that when you go inside, you cut so that the internal lip is very much regular and not the ragged edges are present. Now see, there is no cortex, there is only nucleus, hard nucleus of a mature cataract, which can be easily prolapsed into the anterior chamber. And with the help of the sheets gland, you can prolapse it. Now this may not be always easy, that you have a hard cataract and it comes out and it saves a lot of effort to remove any cortex. Sometimes it can go bad. This is one of the case where you have a micro-ophthalmic eye, 7.5 millimeter corneal diameter with the coloboma here, you can see, and look at the size of the nucleus that has been removed. Completely black nucleus comes as ICC along with the capsule. Trying to remove such kind of a nucleus with the phaco is like sacrificing your cornea. SICS is actually boon in such a case. Especially we know we are staying in the developing country where patients still come to us with the bilateral mature cataract. This is another case with a post-uveitic eye. And the way to go here for dilatation of the pupil is doing a synecholysis and SOS if needed, sphincterotomy. We know in such cases, sometimes iris is so much atrophic that use of iris hoops or even any ring can basically tear apart the iris totally. So synecholysis, SOS sphincterotomy is way to go in such cases. Nucleus is generally not hard, it's complicated and soft nucleus which can easily prolapse. You see here use of anterior chamber maintainer, which keeps your anterior chamber maintained at all the position and all the steps of the surgery. It works like a third hand of the surgeon. Again, similar case, just skip this. This is again one with the small pupil in the PXS. The important thing that I wanted to show in this case is that when you have a small pupil you don't have availability of the hoops, ring or anything, even if you can make it dilate up to 6 millimeter, it is good enough, especially in SICS. It becomes very challenging situation in the phaco, but SICS can be easily managed in such cases. With the little pressure, the nucleus can be prolapsed. This appears like an aniridia hypermata, full moon kind of a cataract. No iris here. You follow the same technique, same external internal dissection. This case is again a very important because this patient presented with the glaucoma, but we could not assess the stage of glaucoma, especially we were not able to see the optic disc, but it was noted patient was already on anti-glaucoma. You know, an aniridic patient do present with the foveal hypoplasia, tendency to develop glaucoma. And again, having a liquefied cortex coming up.
Sumit, can you please speak louder, please?
Yes, sir. and then you remove your capsule using a capsular excise forceps. Nucleus can be easily prolapsed into the anterior chamber with the help of the forceps itself. Removing such nucleus is easy, but you need to be very careful while you put the sheets glide inside. But sometimes without MP nuclear support, your sheets glide can hit the posterior capsule directly and cause a PC tear. And this is how we implanted an anaerobic IOL through doing SIS in such case, and patient was doing well post-surgery. So to conclude, the technique of surgery is important to tackle any difficult situation or complicated situation. SICS is a superb combination of a low learning curve and the high scope of customization. And it's a base of all the intraocular surgeries, because any ophthalmologist in the beginning of his career learns SICS as its first surgery. Thank you all for patient listening.
Thank you, Dr. Sumit. It was a very interesting presentation, and what an array of cases that you have shown. Just a few small tips that whenever you're doing a uveitic case, it's better to make two or three iridotomies, because there is a tendency for post-op pupillary blocks in these patients. And of course, you had so many cases that it's really difficult to discuss each and every one. If anyone has any question, I think Sumit will be happy to answer. Any question for Dr. Sumit? Dr. Bharti, are you ready with your presentation? Dr. Bharti? Your audio is off.
Unmute yourself, madam. Bharti, madam, please unmute yourself.
Dr. Bharti?
Sumit, I have sent you by email also. Can you please run it from that side?
Yes.
Okay, what we can do is, till Sumit looks for Dr. Bharti's video, Dr. Neeta, madam, are you ready?
Yes, ma'am. Sumit only has to...
She is very senior, and Dr. Ragni madam was all full of praises for her. She has keen interest in SICS, and she has trained so many senior surgeons who are now very expert and very senior. So welcome, Dr. Neeta.
So thank you, ma'am, for the lovely introduction. And I really thank MOS and BOA for giving me this opportunity. I wanted to talk about this particular procedure because it is something new and I want everybody to be aware of it. Next slide.
My slides visible.
Yeah, they are visible. Can you go to the next one?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So freedom from spectacles is today's mantra. Today's era, everybody wants freedom from glasses. A five-year-old wants with the help of drops. Teenagers want, from teenagers to presbyopes, they will want with refractive surgery. Mm-hmm. Beyond 40, when you have a cataract with intraocular surgery and special IOLs or bioptics, we try to help our customers or patients by altering our technique of surgery, by corneal modulation, or by IOL implantation. Next. As we grow old, our accommodation power definitely reduces, and this accommodation can be enhanced by the following factors. Depth of focus and pupil size gains through astigmatism, spherical aberrations, monovision or micromonovision, intraocular lens implantation and corneal modulation. Next. Smaller the pupil, always better, because pupillary aperture and depth of field are inversely related. However, a pupil size of less than 1 millimeter would cause refraction. An ideal would be a pupil size between 1 and 2 millimeters. When you're operating, if you want optimal results, avoid touching the iris as sphincter damage would distort the pupil and the depth of focus. Next. And against the astigmatism of minus 0.75 with minus 0.5 cylinder at 90 or vice versa, like 0.5 with 0.75 cylinder at 90, works wonders in the reading ability of the patient. Verzilla and Calozzi calculated that a moderate myopic astigmatism can offer pseudophakic patients a spectacle dependence for both good distance and near vision acuity. For optimal results, it needs to be done in the non-dominant eye. The dominant eye will always be used for distant correction. Spherical aberrations, cornea corneal induced Zernike's higher order aberrations play a major role in pseudophakic pseudoaccommodation. Oshika et al. Demonstrated a positive correlation of corneal asphericity and corneal coma aberrations to pseudoaccommodation and pseudophakic eyes. The vertical coma usually helps in pseudoaccommodation. Next. Monovision or micromonovision, if both eyes are equally dominant, preferably the left eye is made myopic by one diopter. If you have one eye distant dominant and other eye near dominant, the near dominant eye is made myopic by, say, around -1 to -1.25 diopters. For a period of time, the brain adapts and the patients have unaided vision for distance as well as near. Intraocular lenses, you have accommodative IOLs, multifocal IOLs, trifocal IOLs, EDOFs, but we are not going to elaborate on this as the purpose of this presentation is to emphasize that a normal monofocal IOL can deliver equivalent results with corneal remodulations. So what is corneal remodulations? Principle is that of a presbyopic LASIK. You render it bifocal or you render it multifocal. Various permutations and combinations, the center is more myopic than the area around it. The center first is in near, and area around it prefers to see far. Over a period of time, brain adapts, and in a second, it can shift the optical center for distance and near. The plasticity of the brain is commendable. So now we come to what we are going to talk about today, the smart SICS procedure. It's a technique which renders the cornea presbyopic, stretch forces acting on the apex while making a 6 mm incision in the 12 o'clock meridian position. You can watch the two central Myers of the keratoscope to realize you have the cornea horizontally stretched before making the incision. One point to note is it is not mandatory what is the preoperative K for these patients. You may have a KV greater than KH, a KV equal to KH, or a KV less than KH. Aim is to achieve a horizontal stretch on table. Simple instruments required, a keratoscope, measuring calipers, and all other instruments as for a standard SICS. In this picture, I have depicted how you would want a horizontally stretched cornea. Either the vertical meridian has to be myopic or at least the cornea has to be circular. And you can notice in the diagram with the keratoscope, from the center of the keratoscope, you're seeing the corneal Myers. Preoperative keratoscopy, usually we have an against the astigmatism in the elderly. It means the horizontal meridian is steep, but we don't want that. We want the vertical. If to begin with, we have a vertically oval mirror, we need at least to make it circular. How do we achieve this? When you're operating, inject visco at 3 o'clock and 9 o'clock meridians. This stretches the horizontal meridian. The keratoscopy mirror would, as I told you previously, become vertically oval. From a vertically oval position, would either be circular or horizontally stretched. Now we have a software which is illuminated. It gives you a basic curve. No, go back. Basic curve of the cornea in red. Go back, Sumit. No, you have to go next. Next. Yeah, no, previous one. It gives you the exit curve in green, which will stretch the cornea horizontally. It gives you verbal instructions as to where to make the incision at the superior meridian. This was developed by Dr. Rajiv Raut, and full credit to him, as now we have software which tells you where is the incision to achieve smart results. Next. Finish the SICS like any other day. While closing, make sure the central Myers are completely circular. That should be the end point. Next day, lo and behold, you have a patient who reads 6x6 for distance and n by 6 for near. This happens in 9 out of 10 patients. You have a happy patient and a more happy resident, as there is no postoperative refraction to be done. Next. The study design that we adopted was a prospective randomized best corrected visual acuity outcome in standard superior incision SICS versus smart SICS at medical institution. Sample size 100 patients in each group, methodology was standard pre-op as in any cataract surgery. However, more emphasis was given on keratometry with an auto K and PACI to check if against the rule astigmatism or corneal thinning was responsible for the In the first group, a standard incisor millimeter incision 1.5 millimeters away from the limbus by saying the 12 o'clock meridian was done. And in the second group, superior incision 1.5 millimeters with entry into the AC is directed by the corneal Myers as seen with a keratoscope intraoperatively. Best corrected visual outcome checked at the end of first week, 6 weeks, and 6 months with logmas chart post-SICS surgery. We acknowledge Dr. Rajiv Raut's contribution to this technique as he was the pioneer to start this and he encouraged us to try it at our institution. The pre and post case were documented. This was purely done to rule out against the rule astigmatism being the cause of pseudoaccommodation. To our surprise, the K readings had no role to play. And against the rule astigmatism of 4 diopters or with the rule of 1 diopters or an emmetrope, all had the same vision in the smart SIC. So you can see over here that 90% of the patients in smart SIC group achieved vision anywhere between 6.6 and 6.9, whereas only about 33% to 40% achieved that in the control group. Next. Same over here in the bar chart form. Next. We have followed up these patients for any progress in the stretcher, subsequent increase in thinning by pachymetry. However, with the 6 months to 1 year follow-up, we have progression. Hence, we safely conclude that this is the future of cataract surgery, which is pharma-dependent, machine-independent. Power to deliver multifocality at minimum cost lies with the ophthalmologist. So I think should be definitely adapted by most surgeons. Next. Thank you so much for a patient listening.
Dr. Anita, very nice talk.
Thank you,
so
ma'am.
Any question?
Yes, can I ask one question to Anita, madam?
Yes, please.
Madam, the refraction which was there day one post-operative, was it the same on after 6th week also?
Yeah. Santosh, it is really a miracle. I have done it in an institution where I cannot lie about it because there are many people. So you're doing it in a private setup. You can always say whatever results you achieved. There is definitely a query attached to it. But in an institution, it was a topic for my resident. And believe me, they were so happy in that particular year where we did this because no refraction had to be done. Patients were walking around 6-6 and what, you know, the K was irrespective of the K, they were reading it. And it had like, it was a thesis topic. So at the end of 6 months, you check and it would remain the same. So it is stable in whatever changes you're doing, remaining constant and stable.
And which viscoelastic was used for stretching the
body? HPFC 2%. Simple standard stuff. Simple standard stuff. Nothing great.
And everything was removed at the end of surgery and nothing. Just you have to observe
nothing.
The Maya.
Only thing is like, you know, I think Dr. Rajiv Raut makes one entry before he injects the visco. I didn't make any entry because I found it very easy to do the stretch without entering into the eye. I injected with a needle and got the stretch within seconds.
Madam,
so it's very easy to modulate and stretch the horizontal edin if you have not opened the eye before you enter.
Nita madam, how many days you are using Rajiv Raut formula in your institute? Hello?
It's more than a year.
So from the time we are doing it, we have continued to use it.
I think it's more than a year, madam, is it? Am I right? More than 1 year?
No, this is almost like 2 years. We presented in 2019. Now it is 2021.
Okay.
More than 2 years.
I think with such fantastic results, you should come up with a publication so that, you know, we can all...
I know, ma'am, but I am unable to prove how I am getting the results.
Yeah.
It is very difficult to publish unless I can show how I am getting it. I don't have a pentagram at my institute. And it becomes very difficult. I'm not getting any corneal thinning. So unless I have a pentacam with an anterior and posterior float, I will not be able to document and show that it is happening. But it is happening.
But
Dr. Raut, you can try it at your
institute. Dr. Raut's theory is that he changes angle.
I need
angle
to be fully
kappa.
Convinced to... Yes. I need some more time to be convinced.
Yeah.
He really...
It is not something difficult to try, no? It is really very easy to try. We are doing the same thing, isn't it?
Yeah, I did try, but then I think you need to be really, like, as you said, you need to give in a thesis and you really need to put in as a research project to follow it up and then see the results. Maybe, yeah, someday when I'm off all this COVID and everything, I'll do it.
Sure, ma'am, sure. Yeah. But let me tell you, it is working. I mean, he is not talking out of his hat. It's working.
No, no, I am not saying it. He must be having a scientific basis. He's so very sure of it. Only thing, yeah, whether it's going to work for all of us or not, that part has to be, you know, ascertained.
Madam is happy there.
I really thank him because he encouraged me to do it and it worked for us. So I can vouch on the fact that it works.
One more question. One more question.
Raju Raut formula, yeah?
No, one more question, scientific question. Dr. Raut says that he changes angle kappa after the surgery. Yeah, is it possible? Yeah. A quick comment by Dr. Ruchi madam.
He says it changes the angle, but again, I have no ways to document it. So I would not say how it happens. I'm just saying it happens.
But you are happy with that.
It's very difficult to...
It would be better that I don't comment because I have not done that surgery. So it's better that somebody who has more experience should talk about it.
Have you noticed that even during your routine surgeries, does angle kappa change after the surgery?
I have no ways to document it, sir. So how will I do?
I think let's leave it here. Let's all work on it and let's maybe we will come up with a...
Sure. Thanks everybody for a patient listening. And please do try it. I'm just here to create an awareness. And maybe someday somebody can prove that it works and how it works. And then we would be
I'm sure Dr. Raut is already working on it and he'll come up with something very...
No, he has an IJO presentation on it. If anybody wants details, I think you all can go and type IJO software and you will get it.
We can measure angle kappa by iTrace.
Madam, he has explained everything in ISM SICS workshop last week.
Okay.
So I think the fault is at our level that we are not able to pick it up. So I think we can go to the next talk, Dr. Bhavi.
I'm starting my presentation.
Yeah.
Because this problem is solved. Can you see the...
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Clearly. Clear.
This is a case of grade 5 cataract with bad cornea and coloboma of iris with disturbed anterior vitreous face. In this case, my primary concerns were twofold: compromised corneal endothelium and capsulozonular weakness, which I had to take care during surgery. The anticipated complications which could happen in this case were corneal endothelial damage, Descemet's membrane detachment, zonular dehiscence, posterior capsular rupture, and inadvertent intracapsular lens extraction. Looking at hardness of cataract, we opted for a bigger incision than what we normally use in SICS. No diathermy was used. Before entering the anterior chamber, we made a triplanar side port and then entered the anterior chamber and did the trypan blue assisted capsulorexis. We made very big capsulorexis. As there was zonular dehiscence, we were very very slow and gentle while making capsulorexis. After capsulorexis, anterior chamber was entered. The inner lip of entry was larger than the outer lip. Nucleus was brought to the anterior chamber by the help of two Sinsky hooks. Nucleus was then delivered by viscoexpression without stressing the zonules. Bimanual irrigation aspiration was done, and here you can see the zonular dehiscence. The capsule in that weak area is being pulled during irrigation aspiration. So, it was not completed. We sutured the SICS incision to make it watertight and converted it into closed chamber. At this juncture, we entered through pars plana route and vitrectomy probe was inserted through pars plana route, while irrigation port was inserted from incision site. Vitrectomy was performed through pars plana route. And then we put the CTR. The CTR went into the bag very nicely and smoothly. And it almost closed the colobomatous area. You can see the body of CTR, but not the edge, supporting the dehiscent area. CTR was inserted with the help of forceps, going inside the anterior chamber and leaving the trailing end of CTR at the side of capsular edge. A side port incision was made for SFT and irrigation aspiration was done. Irrigation aspiration was done partly by bimanual irrigation aspiration and partly by vitrectomy cutter through suction mode. We were lucky that we did not use the vitrectomy cutter as there was no vitreous. We removed one of the stitches and pushed three-piece foldable IOL into the bag with the help of forceps. It was very well centered, and then we did single fourth row pupilloplasty to make the pupil circular and central. Now we have to take care of coloboma of iris. One SFT near the pupillary margin and the other stitch was taken just below the pupillary margin with the help of 10-0 nylon from one end and 26 gauge needle from the other end. We leave the 10-0 nylon needle there only and with the help of forceps we stretch the iris. So that we can insert the 26 gauge needle. We don't have to insert the needle fully. At this time, we catch hold of needle and pierce the iris with the help of 10-0 nylon needle rather than 26 gauge needle. Because at a later time, we get a hole in iris as a result of piercing by needle, which is aesthetically not appealing. Enough time was taken. We are going now for fourth row pupilloplasty. This is first row. Then the second throw, then the third throw, and now the fourth throw. You have to clean the surface from viscoelastic, otherwise it becomes sticky and difficult to handle. We pull it and the edges of iris become closer. We cut the stitches from both the ends. still the gap was too much. Now we will further give one more stitch to close the gap. Again, iris is pierced by 10 nylon needle rather than 26 gauge needle. These micro forceps are easily available in the OT if vitreoretina setup is there. We are again going for single pass 4th row pupilloplasty. We remove the viscoelastic by gush of fluid. We have to be very, very careful. Find the gap, go inside the loop, because in such cases anything can go wrong anytime. We tied the knot tightly so that iris is nicely opposed. And we stitched the conjunctiva. Now you can see this is first and second post-op day slit lamp pictures. Single most important priority in this particular one-eyed elderly lady was safety. Unaided 6-6, N6, 0 astigmatism, 2.2 mm incision, all this talk were irrelevant in this clinical situation. Every surgeon should have his priorities clear, which are tailor-made for that particular clinical situation. Thank you for attention.
Lovely, ma'am, lovely. Very nice.
Excellent take-home message also.
Thank you so much. So should we proceed to the next speaker?
Yes,
Dr.
Please.
Nikhil Nasta.
Dr. Yes,
Nikhil
ma'am.
Nasta, are you there?
Yes, ma'am, I'm here. I'm ready.
Yeah, okay. He's ex-secretary, Bombay Ophthalmologist Association, 2016-17. He was assistant professor at Sumaya for 7 years and now practicing cataract and refractive surgeon at his two centers in Mumbai. He has taught SICS to many students during his stint as a PG teacher. So welcome, and over to Dr. Nikhil Nasta.
Thank you, ma'am. Is this visible? It is, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, ma'am. So I'm talking on SICS in difficult situations. And why do we need SICS in a current scenario is the first question. It has advantages. It's cost effective. It doesn't depend on machines. It can be done anywhere. And it's a rescue surgery if there's a PCR during FACO. During the FACO training program, we have converted to SICS very often where the residents couldn't manage that. Advantage is it's preferred surgery in a hand of a beginner for complicated cases like brown cataracts, hard white cataracts, non-dilating pupils, floppy iris, subluxations, when the cornea is a little decompensated or compromised, nano-ophthalmic, micro-ophthalmic eyes, and so on. So will we prefer SICS and FACO in these cases? This is what we're talking about here. These are hard, brown, mature, intumescent and posterior polar with maybe extension behind, so pre-existing PC rents. intraoperatively, if there is an Argentinian flag sign, if there's an excess runoff, difficulty in cracking, poor visibility, high pressure during surgery, or a rent, depending on the size of nucleus left behind and what is the stage of surgery, we may want to convert. In a hard cataract, difficulty in doing phaco is capsule rexus usually runs off. There's a blowout syndrome if we do an excessive hydro. I usually prevent hydro much. Difficulty in nucleus chopping. We need a higher phaco power depending on what machine we are using. If it's an Infinity, Ozil and Centurion, it's a little easier. Then chance of zonular weakness, higher chances of a PCR. So SICS is still a safer bet. And this is one video. Let me see if it... Okay, so in this, what's happening is there's a trypanblue staining and then we are proceeding. And as we go ahead, it's a little difficult. The rexus itself is creating a problem. It's not happening the way I intended to happen. I avoid using the rexus forceps. I'm happier with a cystidome always. This is a very tiny rexus. It's not going to happen. And on top though, it's become a capsulotomy only. So it's a complete mess up. I have to use a forcep now to extend this, but it's so tiny. So I will have to debulk this nucleus, which I'm doing right now. And then I'm thinking what to do. How do I proceed? I am a little confused in this case. Eventually, I'm going to decide at the end of this to extend this rexus C. It's already extended on its own, so there's not much to think about. Now, all I have to do is complete it, save whatever I can. So I'm trying to complete the rexus in the little margin. It's not easy, it's difficult. And okay, we managed that, but we still have that extension of the rexus. So I'm deciding now to convert it. And this patient has been blocked, so easy to convert now. Now we are doing this extension and shifting it to an SICS. I don't have a forward button on this. But then the rest of the steps go same and I managed to complete the surgery at the end of it. If I go to the next slide, then how do we reduce complication rates? So adequate capsular staining, never shy away from staining the capsule. Use of a rexus forceps or a retinal micro forceps for a controlled rexus. The movement of this forceps is something that needs a little experience. A gentle hydro, we don't want that blowout to happen. And to prefer an SICS surgery or a divide and conquer phaco. Now, how do we reduce complication rates? So if there's a PCR in a hard cataract, put in a lot of dispersive visco through the side port, remove the phaco probe, try and prolapse the nucleus piece into the AC, and then convert to SICS for delivery of nucleus, finish it with a good anterovitrectomy, and place in the IOL depending on what's the PCR size. This is another video which was on a different machine now. So here what's happening is, this is a hard one. Crack and all is okay so far. But then the issue starts a little later, as we will see. So far it's going pretty all right. And I'm able to chop it very well and get this one piece out. It's going in a forward mode. I've forwarded it quite a bit. So it's playing in double speed. But now there will be a problem here where we will have a rent here. And then suddenly we'll not know what to do. So we'll have to then convert the case. So now we're bringing it up a little bit into the AC, like I said, putting in a lot of visco dispersive and converting the case to an SICS. So there will be an extension and delivery and then putting in a lens. If we go ahead, then SICS is also indicated in a small pupil, like a pseudo exfoliation or a posterior, if there's a uveitis, post uveitic patient, rigid pupils, diabetic and so on. We can try viscodilatation. We can use intracameral midricane, phenocaine, synecholysis. I personally do a stretch pupilloplasty. I don't usually do sphincterotomies, but and I don't have much experience with the malignant rings, but folks, I have tried. In pseudo exfoliation, the problem is that there's zonular lysis, the lens may subluxate, there's poor dilatation, secondary glaucoma. Floppy iris is another thing where I would prefer to do an SICS than a phaco, because once that iris starts popping out, it's very, very difficult and it's one hell of a surgery after that. This is a bad case. So in this, what's happening is everything that can go wrong is going wrong. There's a lot of bleeding. This lens is just not coming out. There's so much of a struggle here. And so this is not dilating. I've ended up doing a sphincterotomies, which usually I don't like to do. And then eventually the nucleus delivers and we stitch the whole thing up. if you go further, then in a subluxated cataract, which is like in traumas, you do X or whatever the reason may be, after evaluating it, check for anterior chamber depth abnormalities. Somewhere it's a little shallow, somewhere it's a little deep. If there's a generalized weakness, we can plan what to do next. So we can do a wider tunnel with scleral pockets, larger excess, prolapse the nucleus with least zonular stress, and try to do a phaco sandwich. Now, adjuncts here would be using iris hooks, capsular hooks. Depending on what we want, we may do a CTR also. Then in a subluxated cataract, this is how we proceed. And yeah. So this is one more video, which is showing. Okay, this one isn't playing at all. So we'll go ahead. Sorry about that. This was cataract in a corneal opacity. So in this, we need to optimize visualization by positioning the patient correctly, retroillumination. So what I do in my practice is, I have Dr. R.C. Shah sir's, there's an attachment, OmniGlow, which really, it's like a chandelier light. So it lights up everything and the glow of the microscope becomes comparable with a Lumera. So even on my 1FR, I get a very good glow and that's really brilliant. It's cost effective and that's what I usually use. We will stain the capsule, use a soft shell technique, and we will do an SICS. So this is how we do it in a corneal opacity case. So to conclude, even though phaco is now a gold standard for cataract surgeons, SICS does have a place for complications and for difficult cases. Thank you so much.
Lovely, Nikhil, very nice.
Yeah, thank very you, nice set of videos, Nikhil, that you have shown. And Dr. Bharti also, very educative video it was. I couldn't comment it that time. And actually, there were so many things to be discussed that I think we can take the discussion on individual subjects at the end, because there was so many topics in that presentation. So let's go to the next speaker as of now. Dr. Bharti, would you...
Dr. Pankaj is there? Because... Dr.
Yes, ma'am. He has another talk in another meeting. As soon as he finishes, I'll just call him.
Dr. Pranav. Dr. Pranav.
Yes, ma'am.
Dr. Pranav is here.
Dr. Pranav. Okay. So, Dr. Yeah. Pranav's topic is management of astigmatism in SICS. He's a senior resident in RIO, Motilal Nehru Medical College, Allahabad. He's assistant editor of your YouTube, official YouTube channel of USC. Very nice. He's practicing cataract and refractive surgeon with medical retina. So over to Dr. Pranav Saluja.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. So I'll be speaking on astigmatism management. I would like to thank Ragni ma'am and Laane sir and BOA for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, Pranav. You are family. Thank you for being here.
Thank you so much. So I'll start with the presentation. So as we all know that technological advances in ophthalmology has grown by leaps and bounds, and it is not an ophthalmologist's duty only to improve the patient's vision, but it is also to refine it. And proper management of astigmatism is one which can lead to excellent visual outcomes, even in SICS. And to achieve emetropia is the target nowadays.
Sir, Miguel,
surgery are mainly painless visual recovery. We need to give spectacle independence to the patient. We have to correct the pre-existing astigmatism and lower the amount of surgical induced astigmatism that we create. And repeatability of a surgical result is very important. So as we all know that against the rule, astigmatism is the one which is more common in older patients, especially in the ones in the cataract patients that we deal with. Mainly the prevalence of preoperative astigmatism has been seen to be 86.6%, and greater than one diopter has been seen in 35 to 40%, and greater than 1.5 in 20% of the patients. So mainly the factors affecting are that incision characteristics is the main thing which affects the surgically induced astigmatism, the use of cautery in SICS, and whether we use a suture or the non-use of a suture. So we measure it mainly by retinoscopy, keratometry, or corneal topography. Corneal topography is the one that we prefer, but in some cases where there is poor fixation, corneal abnormalities and distorted Myers, we go for manual keratometry. So So incision characteristics is the main thing that results in the amount of astigmatism that we create during the surgery. So the first thing is that the size of the incision. So the larger the size of the incision, the more the astigmatism is created because of the flattening of the cornea. And the smaller the incision, the lesser the flattening. The other thing is that the distance from the cornea. So the closer we are to the cornea, the more the amount of astigmatism is created. And configuration of the incision is another thing which is important. The target is always to hit the astigmatically neutral zone. This was a concept given by Koch. And this is a funnel-shaped area, which is mainly 3 to 3.5 millimeter from the limbus, and it widens as it moves away. So usually the configuration can be either smile, straight, frown, chevron, or blue menthol. And the least, the ones that we prefer usually is the frown incision. And even chevron and blue menthol are a little difficult for starters, but it leads to least amount of astigmatism that is created. So the other thing is that the incision type. So where we put the incision, that is either we can put it on the superior or the temporal part of the eye. And in during superior incision, it is usually taught during our postgraduates graduation, and it is easier to learn. There is more wound protection because of the lid and less foreign body sensation, but it leads to more astigmatism. While the temporal incision is easier in deeper sockets, but it is difficult for a starting surgeon, and also in small eyes. And the conjunctiva is spared, which is helpful in future trabeculectomy cases. So the other thing is that the phenomena of coupling. So the closer we are to the cornea, as we've talked about, the more amount of astigmatism is created when we put an incision. And it states that the flattening effect is achieved at the tissue and steepening is produced 90 degree away. So when we flatten one meridian of the cornea, we will steepen the other meridian, which is 90 degree. So this was a study done by Gokhale sir, and he stated that this, he found out that the surgically induced astigmatism in superior is the most, which is around 1.28 diopter. This can also be used to correct the amount of astigmatism if there is any pre-existing. Superior temporal is the one location where there is least surgically induced astigmatism created. And also the incision length, which we already talked about, creates the most amount of astigmatism. Also, the other thing is that cautery, excessive cautery can increase astigmatism due to sclerotic shrinkage and scleral necrosis. So we should always do minimal cautery during a surgery. So how to correct the pre-existing astigmatism? In cases where there is mild astigmatism, we usually operate on the steeper axis, which is very important. So we have to do topography or keratometry before and do a good pre-op assessment, so that we know which is the steeper axis, and we should also always apply the incision there. Then the other thing is, if the astigmatism is more than one diopter, we can also go for limbal relaxing incisions. These are incisions which are made at 90% depth, just in front of the limbus and on the steeper meridian, so that we flatten it. So this is a SICS case in which we did a LRI. So the incision is created, and we usually make the main incision and the tunnel first and then do the LRI, because otherwise the distance that we take is usually the amount of with the help of a nomograms. There are multiple nomograms that are given, like Nickerman and Hill, and other nomograms are also there, which are online LRI calculator. So this is a diamond set knife. It is a preset knife, which is around 600 micron. There are also stepped knife which come. And it is imperative to check the calculations to prevent any mishap in this case. And usually the plus cylinder axis, steeper K and LRI position is all are all in the same axis, and that should be kept in mind. Then there are multiple nomograms, as we've talked about. A 1 clock hour of paired incision usually corrects around one diopter of corneal astigmatism, and it changes according to the age. Also, we should also consider the effect of our SICS incision, which will cause a surgical induced astigmatism, and accordingly correct the astigmatism that is already there. So these are other nomograms which are given already. So usually we can also create a single incision or a paired incision, whichever we want, and accordingly the amount of astigmatism is correct. So the advantages are that there is less tendency of the shift in the resultant cylindrical axis in this case, and irregular corneal flattening and irregular astigmatism is lesser rather than the ones in arcuate incisions or the corneal relaxing incisions. And it is easier to perform. It also, the paired LRIs exhibit a consistent 1:1 coupling ratio. The other thing is that we can go for opposite clear corneal incision. So this was a concept given by Lieber and Dan, and they added an identical incision on the opposite side. In SICS also, we can give a clear corneal incision on the opposite end. The mean astigmatism corrected with this technique was around 1.66 plus minus 0.5 diopter. So the technique involves creating two biplanar 3.2 millimeter incisions, which are 180 degree apart, and they are placed just 1.5 to 2 millimeter inside the edge of the limbal vessels along the steeper meridian. So this is a flow chart representing what we've already talked about. In low cases of astigmatism, we go for a crown incision 3 millimeter behind the cornea, which is usually at the astigmatically neutral zone. In moderate cases, we can go for a small incision along the steeper meridian, and we go for a straighter incision because it leads to more flattening rather than a crown incision. In high cases, we go for LRIs or OCCIs. If there is post-operative astigmatism, we can go for astigmatic keratotomy, a wound revision, or an exam laser. So the take-home message is that we should always do a careful identification of astigmatism magnitude, which is usually done by a good pre-op assessment. The next thing is that we should always choose a stepladder approach based on the magnitude of the surgery, and techniques can be combined effectively for higher levels of astigmatism. And we should always operate on the steeper axis. Thank you.
Dr. Pranav, a very nicely shared algorithm for management of pre-op as well as post-op astigmatism. I think if we start the discussion on it, it'll take one or two more hours, and I think we are running short of time, Dr. Ragini. So Dr. Bharti, I would suggest, please let's finish the talks first.
So is Dr. Pankaj available now? Has he come?
Yes, ma'am.
He is a treasurer, but I put two of his talks at the same time and poor thing is running around. Sorry, Pankaj.
No, ma'am.
He's my brother. He's a treasurer of MOS. Pranav, thank you so much. Well done and nice to see you.
Thank you. And you are so lucky, Pranav, that you have got such a nice partner in Ravi Ragini, madam. She's so soft and so well, so affectionate. So he's treasurer Maharashtra of
thank
the
Malachi.
He's treasurer.
He's a crorepati treasurer of MOS.
मेरे पहले दो लोग हैं करोड़पति आप लोगों ने बनाया है संतोष सर है मेरे पहले उसके पहले आप हैं I'm just carrying out the tradition sir continue
Oh, Santosh is going to be the president of MOS now
acha
after Jignesh bhai then Santosh
yes. Santosh bide
yeah
yes okay, okay. So, Dr. Pranav is a practicing cataract and refractive surgeon, and I can see his beautiful hospital in Jalgaon. How far is this from Bombay?
8 hours, 400 kilometers.
Okay, okay. So, his topic is very interesting, challenging situations in SICS.
I know it's getting late, Ruchi, but I must interrupt. So, Ruchi definitely will have to come. And I've been telling Madam Santosh Bhai and Pankaj that for the MOS conference now, which is in Nasik and Kolhapur, they have to come. So the MOS faculty is here, ma'am, Pranav, everybody. So Pankaj and everybody is now going, Anita, all of us are here, ma'am, now you have to come. You, Ruti, everybody
you
have to come.
You are so
to Nasik,
warm,
Kolhapur.
So affectionate, I will surely come.
Zinda rahe to aa jayenge.
Kya?
Zinda rahe to aa jayenge.
Oh,
Ruchi, don't say such things. May you live 100 years. Ma'am, Bharti ma'am, usko daato.
Ruchi to mere saath hi padhi likhi hai. Aur main kya bolu, ye to mere saath hi hum log bade hue hain. We have grown together. Maine usko dekha hai as a resident. Apne boss se achhi surgery karte hue.
I think we can go to the talk now.
Thank you, madam. May I start?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
Thank you, chair, co-chair, moderator, for giving me a chance, and POA and MOS also for including me in such a wonderful feast of academic events. SICS in challenging conditions. So SICS definitely has an universal applicability in such conditions where you have a brown cataract, hypermature cataract, small pupil, coloboma. So these are the conditions where definitely we can always think of doing an SICS rather than going for FICO, subluxated cataracts. So what are the difficulties we face in hypermature cataract? There, capsular rexis is difficult due to absent red glow, poor capsule visibility, risk of rexis extension into periphery due to raised intralentical pressure, milky cortex, varying hardness and size of nucleus, and commonly associated fibrosis of posterior capsule. So the tips are, you can have a bigger tunnel, dye staining techniques, OVDs for AC formation on also injected into the capsular bag, have an envelope capsular tummy technique, nucleus has to be delivered into AC by visco expression, hard nucleus can be done by FECO sandwich or FECO fracture technique. Just will show you a video of a mid dilating pupil hypermature cataract. Here, to have a good rexis, pupilloplasty, stretch pupilloplasty was done with the hooks. And then with the dye techniques, rexis with the help of rexis forceps was done. One pole was dissected out, delivered into the AC, and then the nucleus was delivered. The other condition is posterior polar cataract. The difficulties are pre-op evaluation. It could be exile, well circumscribed, densely white onion bulk pattern. 10 to 20% can be associated with congenital posterior capsule dehiscence. So again, the tips in posterior polar cataract is hydrodissection is contraindicated. You can have a hydro-free dissection made by sweeping a cyclodacyl spatula. Hydrodelineation is preferred. Epinocular bowel is carefully removed, and patient's counseling about the risk is very important. Small pupil, the causes are senile, pseudo-exfoliation, meiotic pupils, diabetic, posterior uveitic, and trauma. Again, the difficulties we have is cataract assessment. We don't know the type of nucleus. Again, capsulotomy is difficult in such cases, and nucleus delivery is also difficult. So again, the tips are use generous ocular viscoelastics. You can have a pharmacological midriasis, intracameral adrenaline can be used. Again, mechanical pupil stretching, just as it was shown in previous video. Multiple sphincterotomies can be done, sector iridectomy, keyhole iridectomy, and synecdochoelasis without partial iridectomy is also the choice. This was one of the small pupil where blind rexis below the iris was tried, a big rexis, just to show you. And then with the help of rexis forceps, it was extended well. So a big rexis helped to have a nucleus out nicely. In pseudo-exfoliation, again, the difficulties are weak zonules associated with phacodonesis, rigid small pupil, compromised corneal endothelium, peripheral iridocapsular adhesions, increased risk of posterior capsular tear, tendency for postoperative iritis and fibrin formation, and association with glaucoma. So again, the tips in pseudo-exfoliation will be a meticulous gentle capsulotomy, gentle nucleus prolapse with minimal zonular stress, adequate use of ocular viscoelastics, and anterior chamber IOL should always be avoided. Never use anterior chamber IOL. There are some cases of complicated cataract where the difficulties are of residual inflammation, small pupil, difficult capsulotomy, postoperative inflammation, flare-up are the chances. So again, the tips for complicated cataract are control inflammation for at least 6 to 8 weeks, surgery should always be done under the cover of systemic and topical steroids. Ocular viscoelastics use should be adequate. Synovialysis, always use OVDs, cyclodialysis, spatula, and Mannes scissor. Do a gentle capsulotomy. Always implant IOL in the bag and prefer surface modified or surface coated IOLs. And always see for postoperative papillary mobility. This was a case from hypermature cataract with calcified capsule. This was a complicated cataract with a thin seal preoperatively with all occlusive pupillae. Here I tried to enter and tried the dye techniques also. Methyl trifine blue was used. And then multiple sphincterotomies with Vanas was attempted. Now some there is some visibility and we could see access the cataract here. So what are the subluxated cataracts where we what difficulties we face is weakened zonules, lack of zonules, intraoperative vitreous loss, nucleus subluxation, intraoperative IOL centration and its long-term stability. Causes could be trauma, pseudoexfoliation, Marfan syndrome, homocystinuria, and Weill-Marchesani syndrome. So the tips is preoperative characterization and localization of zonular defect. Ascertain whether there is vitreous in the AC. Identify any angle recession or synechia and always try to use a capsule tension ring. The success of surgery always depends on identification of the problem, judgment and application. Thanks.
Pankaj. Hi.
Yes, sir.
Very well explained. And congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
So nice video, nice presentation. So is Dr. Rajesh Joshi available?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. And today, no, the whole MOS team is here. I forgot to tell you, Rajesh is the joint secretary.
Yeah.
So the whole MOS is here. Starting from Lane sir to say that you, Ruchi and Pranav and everybody should come, Umesh bhai. So the whole MOS is here today.
I'm going to post it in Jharkhand Ophthalmological Society's channel and Facebook also. All these sessions. So
thank you, ma'am.
I will. Today only I will do it. So Dr. Rajesh Joshi is the past chairman scientific committee and president of Vidarbha Ophthalmological Society, associate professor GMC Nagpur. His area of interest is cataract and refractive surgery. His topic is the savior. Ab aap mujhe ye bataye ki what is Vidarbha Ophthalmological Society? Vidarbha means?
Yeah, it is a 11 districts of Maharashtra only. It's a part of Maharashtra.
It's a part of Maharashtra. Seven districts are included in VOS. Vidarbha Ophthalmic Society.
Okay. It's a national part of Maharashtra, which is called as Vidarbha.
It is a Nagpur and around.
Yes. Nagpur and around, yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. At the outset, I thank to BOA and MOS for the opportunity. My special thanks to Lahani sir, Ragini madam, Dr. Parikshit, Dr. Pritham, Sumit, Swapnesh, and all the office bearers of MOS and BOA. In fact, my job has been made easy by Dr. Nikhil and Pankaj. Most of the slides, they match with their slides only. When we need conversion, whenever there is an extension while performing phacoemulsification, nucleus drop in the initial stages of performing phacoemulsification, poor visibility during phaco, very hard nucleus. I remember Lahane sir calls it as a Marathwada cataract, or we call it as a Vidarbha cataract, and machine failure, of course. So if you don't convert and proceed with the FICO emulsification in the situation where you need to convert, you may get such type of cornea postoperatively. So if you don't want such type of cornea, it's better to convert. Now, this is the situation where I think Nikhil has elaborated well. And there is an Argentinian flag sign. And some of the proficient phaco emulsification surgeon, they can perform phaco emulsification very well. But I think in such type of cataract, what we want is the clear cornea and the vision postoperatively. So it's always better to convert to small incision cataract surgery, create a tunnel. This has been well demonstrated by Ruchi Madam. And bring the nucleus into the anterior chamber and move by visco expression. This is what we do at GMC. We teach our residents visco expression only and place an IOL. The second situation would be like this, a calcified anterior capsule, thick anterior capsule, wherein there is a lot of difficulty in performing capsular excess itself. If you don't have a good capsular excess, it's like losing a battle before you fight it out. So good capsular excess is what we need. And if you find such folds over the anterior capsule, make it's clear that the capsular excess is going to be difficult in such a situation. So I'm creating a capsular excess in an area where there is a thin capsule and forming the anterior chamber with the help of viscoelastic. But at some point, I found that it's going towards the periphery. This is an edited video and it's in fast forward. So it looks very easy to perform, but it takes a lot of time. And while performing capsular excess in such type of situation, the zonules may go weak. So you have a big nucleus, very hard nucleus. And I think phaco emulsification would be difficult in such a situation. So it's always good to convert to SICS. Second situation will be like a Morganian cataract, wherein you will have a difficult capsular excess, anterior capsular calcification, and the nucleus, which may be very hard and a small nucleus, and zonular weakness may add to all the problems which I have just told to you. So better way is to convert and remove the small nucleus and put an IOL. The another would be hazy cornea. Now here, the cornea at the beginning only it was hazy, so performing rexis with difficulty, but still there was some glow and carrying out phaco emulsification. But if you have a hazy cornea, you lose confidence in chopping of the nucleus itself. You feel that you are missing something in your vision and you are trying to perform phaco emulsification blindly. I magnified the view and I thought with the magnification, I would be able to do the phaco emulsification. But the cornea was getting very hazy. So I thought it's better to convert to SICS than going ahead with phaco emulsification. So the nucleus was brought into the anterior chamber and it was removed with the help of visco expression. So next is to put an IOL. Another thing, we get many lens induced glaucoma, particularly after the first wave of COVID. Now we are getting such phacoelytic glaucoma and small pupil. So rexis itself becomes difficult in such a situation. We'll go to another situation wherein there is a tremulousness of head, but the nucleus is not that hard. You can see some amount of glow, but constant tremulousness of head is there. So the anterior capsule was stained with trifam blue it's always good to stain the capsule with the trifamily, because while performing either phacoemulsification or SICS, sometimes you lose the entry capsular margin. If you have staining of the entry capsule, it's always good. Now performing phacoemulsification and slowly trying to chop the nucleus, but I find that it's rotating, but not, and the chamber is also deepening. And at some time, I found that the nucleus is going into the vitreous cavity. So if you don't have vitreoretinal surgeon in your setup and you want that nucleus should be out, better to convert to small incision than carrying away with phacoemulsification. Removing the nucleus and performing vitrectomy, all the entry segment surgeons must know how to perform entry vitrectomy so that they can go ahead with the vitrectomy whenever it is required and clear the vitreous at least from the anterior chamber and put an intraocular lens over the entry capsular rim. This is what is the importance of staining the capsule. This is again another situation wherein it is a very hard cataract and the capsular axis became difficult. And again, it was converted to SICS. So your promise should not prove hollow to your patient. Do not hesitate to convert when in need. Post-op visual gain is important than creating complications. Thank you all for your patience listening.
Yeah, Rajesh, very well done and very well explains something in difficult situations.
Thank you, sir.
So, anyone has any particular question for Dr. Joshi or for any of the speakers? I think Dr. Ragini, we've already exceeded the time. So, please suggest if you would like to continue this.
No, Ruchi, it is entirely up to Madam, you, Umesh Mai, and everybody, because this hall is vacant now. So you are such a good teacher. Madam is there. It is all up to you to wind up or keep Santosh Bhai, you and Nikhil, please. Madam and Ruchi, please decide. It is entirely up to you because this hall is Lani vacant
sir
now.
Lani sir is there. Sir, do you want to speak something?
I think, Ruchi, it was a very good session and I was listening because another session was not there because that completed. So I was listening. It was a very good session, good presentations. And I think the both of you have controlled very good this session. So I think now if you want some discussion or that you can do or you can decide about the this one. Session.
So I think let's start from there. Are we all operating right now? Let's start from there.
Yes.
We are operating, but okay. Not much cases, but pediatric cases, traumatic cases, lens-induced glaucomas. Routine cataract, we are not operating.
Okay.
Sir.
We are getting RT-PCR test done and then we are operating.
Yes. We are operating.
The patient and the attendant, we are also doing yes. that because the attendant might spread otherwise. Absolutely
yes,
true.
Yes. Yes, that we are doing.
So our in IPD area, only COVID negative tested people can enter.
Yes.
IPD.
Correct.
It's good.
So we have also done the same thing. We have done the isolation ward. There are 4 isolation ward, common ward. The patients are admitted there. Those who are negative, then they are admitted in the ward. Those who are positive, they go to the COVID ward. So that is what we are doing, or the home isolation. But in Maharashtra, the number is reducing. In Mumbai, it is near about 800-900 per day. So that Mumbai has came down. Some districts of Maharashtra, that is 12 districts of Maharashtra, there is some more cases, but there the wave started late. Secondly, we are getting the mucormycosis. Yes. And in mucor now, people are removing the eyes, I think, without thinking. So we have now circulated the guideline when to touch the eye. See, exantation is not like that, keep the eyes also blind. But exantation, it is on the face. And when such type of exantation, if we can save the eye, and if eye is blind also, so we should save it. So we have now circulated 2 days before when to remove the eye. Otherwise, they should not remove the eye. They can go for the, you can see the in the sinus or whatever they want. But black fungus is really troubling. The deaths are increasing. In Maharashtra, there are 130 deaths. So that is also the one of the major issue now. But now we are getting amputation B. And we are now treating totally free. So under the Mahatma Phule Jan Arogya Yojana, up to 10 lakhs rupees we are giving. And we have identified 131 hospital where the team of the doctor is there. It means we require dental surgeon, we require ENT, ophthalmology, neurosurgery, anesthesia. So all those people, those who are there in those hospitals, now we have all these hospitals are registered under the MJPGY. So that we are doing further.
So thank you very much, sir, and Dr. Ragni, for inviting us all to this wonderful webinar. And I think we would all like to take leave. Hum sab
okay.
Mucor se jude hue bahut puri tarah se. And thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Lani sir.
Thank you so much, Lani sir.
Thank you, Lani madam.
And all Nita madam.
Yes, ma'am. And all welcome.